We will discuss about the tumors of the small and large intestine. You know that the colorectal carcinoma ranks second only to the bronchogenic carcinoma among the cancer killers. The epithelial tumors of the intestine are the major cause of morbidity and mortality worldwide among the tumors of the adenocarcinoma. It represents 70% of all the malignancies arising in the gastrointestinal tract. Small intestine is very uncommon site for any tumor, any type of tumor, benign or malignant. Although it represents 75% of the alimentary tract lengthwise, but the tumors arising from these areas represent only 3 to 6%. Among these tumors in the small intestine, the benign tumor is the adenoma, of which counterpart malignant tumor is the adenocarcinoma. So before going into the colorectal carcinoma, we will discuss about something about the polyps, which we have already discussed. These polyps here are found evidently in the large intestine. So the polyp is a growth of mass which protrudes from the mucous membrane into the lumen. It is a very common colorectal lesion. It may be sessile or pedunculated. So these polyps are of two types: non-neoplastic polyps and the neoplastic polyps. Non-neoplastic polyps represents 90% of all polyps in the large intestine found in the persons over the age of 60 years. So there are four types of these non-neoplastic polyps which never changes into malignant one. They are the hyperplastic or metaplastic polyps. These are the most common type of epithelial polyps arising in the rectosigmoid lesion. There is a epithelial hyperplasia at the base of the crypts, and there is a cystic metaplasia. Long cystically dilated glands are found in the elderly people over the age of 60 to 70 years. It is symptomless and they are not potentially malignant. Second is the inflammatory polyps, also called pseudopolyposis. Due to re-epithelialization of the mucous membrane, which under the any ulcer arising from there, the re-epithelialization leads to excessive formation of the mucous membrane, and that protrudes into the lumen as if it is overhanging. These occurs in cases of inflammatory bowel disease like Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. They are always multiple and they are overgrowth of the mucous membrane. Center of the polyp consists of connective tissue core in which there is a inflammatory cells infiltration are found. These are non-malignant lesions. Next is the hematomatous polyp. Hematoma, you know that it is the indigenous excessive growth of the normal tissue, which are of the site wise they are in the same area. So these are composed as abnormal mixture of tissue indigenous to that part. These are autosomal dominant defect like Peutz-Jeghers polyps and polyposis. It is characterized by the intestinal polyposis along with the melanotic pigmentosa of the lips and mucosa. It is commonly found in jejunum and ileum. It is adolescent, and the childhood who suffers from this hematomatous polyps grossly large, and they are multiple. A macroscopic examination, there is tree-like branching of muscularis mucosa. Again, it is not malignant. The second type of hematomatous polyp is the juvenile or retention polyps, which is found in the children below 5 years in the rectum as solitary polyps. Gross examination, a spherical smooth surface 2 cm in diameter and they are pedunculated. Microscopically, when it is examined, there are cystically dilated glands containing mucosa lined by the normal mucus secreting epithelium cells. And the fourth one is the lymphoid polyps. It is the reactive hyperplasia of the lymphoid tissue in the rectum, which gives rise to the localized lymphoid polyps, also called rectal tonsils. These are solitary or it may be multiple. Microscopically, there are prominent lymphoid follicles over the with the epithelial covering. Now coming to the neoplastic polyps. Neoplastic polyps, that means they are potentially malignant. They may be benign or malignant. Benign epithelial tumors are called adenoma. These adenomatous polyps are neoplasms that range from a small pedunculated lesion to large sessile neoplasm. Age wise, it is 20 to 30% below in the 40 years and 40 to 50% occurs after 60 years. There is a well defined familial predisposition to sporadic adenoma. Potentially malignant it is on the basis of different growth patterns of epithelial architecture and their biological behavior. There are three types of adenomas: tubular adenomas, villous adenoma, and the when the two are in the mixed form, tubulovillous adenoma. Tubular adenoma is a small pedunculated 1 cm average, most common type. All adenomatous lesions arises as a result of epithelial proliferative dysplasia. This dysplasia occurs from mild to severe degree and constitutes the lesion. Carcinoma in situ, when the atypical epithelium lies over the basement membrane, but the basement membrane is still intact and there is a malignant changes in the epithelium, that is dysplasia. It is a precursor lesion for invasive colorectal carcinoma. Hence, the malignant risk with the type of lesion is well established in respect of polyp size and histological architecture and severity of the epithelial dysplasia. Morphologically, they can be from small, sessile and smooth to coarse, lobulated and large stalk. Benign lesions, only branching of the tubular glands which are well supported by lamina propria overlying the muscularis mucosa. The dysplasia is of very mild degree, lining epithelium is large, intestinal with diminished mucin content. Histologically, the stalk is formed of fibrovascular tissue with prominent blood vessels. Dysplastic epithelium lines the glands as tall, hyperchromatic, disordered epithelium, mild to severe. Mild is carcinoma in situ, which is still localized, no metastasis takes place as the basement membrane is intact. Whereas severe, there is an intramucosal carcinoma, clear cut malignant changes in the epithelium, but no metastasis. Then occurs the invasive adenocarcinoma. When these cancer cells or the epithelial cells which has transformed into cancer cells erodes the basement membrane and it invades, then it becomes to the submucosa, then it is called invasive adenocarcinoma. And then there is a villous adenoma. It is always sessile, up to 10 cm without a stalk, large, occurs in older people in the rectum or rectosigmoid region. It presents as a cauliflower like growth projecting 3 cm above the surrounding mucosa. Histologically, villous extension of the mucosa is covered by dysplastic epithelium. When the two tubular and villous adenoma are found together, then it is called tubulovillous adenoma. It may be sessile or pedunculated. Microscopically, mixed pattern of the two are seen. It shows vertical villi and deeper part shows the tubular pattern. Besides these polyps, there is familial polyposis syndrome. These are a growth of disorders with multiple polyposis of colon with autosomal dominant inheritance. So it is linked with the genetics that autosomal dominant inheritance pattern is there. So it is familial adenomatous polyposis FAP, in which there it is autosomal dominant inheritance pattern is there. Innumerable more than 100 polyps which progresses to adenocarcinoma of the colon. There is a germline mutation in the APC gene on chromosome 5q21. Besides, there is a Gardner syndrome, a variation of familial adenomatous polyposis in which multiple osteomas of the mandible is found with the an epidermal cyst along with polyposis. Torquat syndrome, combination of adenomatous polyp with tumors of CNS, that is glioma. Now coming to the malignant colorectal tumors, these colorectal carcinoma, 98% of all cancers in the large intestine are adenocarcinoma, that is arising out from columnar epithelium. The disease accounts for 10% of all cancer deaths in the United States, most common in North America and Europe among the affluent society people because of their food habits. Peak incidence of colorectal carcinoma is 60 to 79 years. In younger age, it takes only if there is some underlying lesion like ulcerative colitis or one of the polyposis syndrome, which I have just now told you. Etiology, the dietary factors. Diet plays an important role. A diet which has got low intake of vegetable fibers and which is easily absorbable, then there is a decreased stool bulk and increased fecal transit time so that the bacterial flora of the intestine is altered and there is a high risk of adenocarcinoma. Consumption of large amount of fatty acids, on breaking down, there is excessive cholesterol and their metabolites which becomes potentially carcinogens by the intestinal bacteria. Consumption of large amount of refined carbohydrates, prolonged period of contact with colonic mucosa leads to change in the bacterial flora of the bowel and then there is a production of carcinogens. Now, pathogenesis. In most of these colorectal carcinoma, there is adenoma carcinoma sequence. It means that the development of carcinoma is from adenomatous polyps. In favor of this adenoma carcinoma sequence, following observations have been seen that the populations that have high incidence of adenoma have high incidence of colorectal cancer and vice versa. Distribution of the adenomas within the colorectum is more or less compatible to that of colorectal cancer. Whenever there is an invasive carcinoma, the surrounding tissues are found to have adenomatous type of tissue. So this is in favor of the adenoma carcinoma sequence. That means the carcinoma of the colon arises from the adenomas. Peak incidence of adenoma precedes by some years to the peak incidence of colorectal carcinoma. Risk of malignancy increases with adenoma related factors like number of adenomas, that is in familial polyposis coli syndrome, which certainly passes into carcinoma. Size of adenoma and type of adenoma, villous type of adenomas have increased risk. Now, in this colorectal carcinoma, the pathogenesis there is also genetic basis of this colorectal carcinogenesis, that is the molecular pathogenesis or genetic mechanism. How the normal cells transforms into a cancer cell is a very complex process and it is still mysterious one. Therefore, various theories on the molecular level have been accounted to explain the pathogenesis of cancer. One is the monoclonality of the tumors. Most human cancers arises from a single clone of the cells by genetic transformation or mutation. The best example is multiple myeloma. Carcinogenesis is a gradual multi-step process which involves many generations of the cells. The various causes act on one after another, what we call multi-hit process, so that the cells so formed are genetically and phenotypically transformed cells having the features of malignancy like excessive growth, invasiveness and distant metastasis. The abnormalities in genetic composition is either inherited or by radiation, which leads to genetic abnormality in cell. Normal cells becomes with abnormal expression, what we call a mutant cells, and they transmit the characters to the next progeny of the cells, which results into cancer. So there is another theory, that is the chromosomal instability for genetic mutation and is always associated with morphological and identifiable changes as in adenoma carcinoma sequence. So this chromosomal instability for genetic mutation is also responsible in 80% cases of colorectal carcinoma development. So as you know that the normal cell, the growth is always regulated, that means mitosis and the apoptosis, by which the cell death is there. There is a balance between the two, so the growth is a regular, that takes place by the regulator genes. Whenever these regulator genes are affected, then in that case there is a no regulation of the mitosis or apoptosis, which leads to abnormal cell growth. These four types of regulator genes are: number one, adenomatous polyposis coli APC gene on 5q chromosome. So its function is that it inhibits the translocation of beta carotene to the nucleus and suppresses the cell growth. That means it doesn't allow the cell to have mitosis abruptly. Whenever these genes are lost or becomes abnormal by mutation, then this control is lost and patient born with one mutant APC gene allele, then there is a large number of polyposis in the colon in early life. But at the age of 20, when the second allele of the chromosome is lost, then there is a malignant transformation of all the polyps into the carcinoma. The next regulator gene is KRS gene on 12P, what we call point mutation. It sends the signal for mitosis. If there is any mutation, no such signal is sent for mitosis, and there the cell proliferation goes on abated. Now there is third regulator gene, which is called deleted colon cancer on 18q, which regulates apoptosis. Apoptosis, you know, it is cell death without any inflammation, which suppresses the excessive growth. But whenever there is any abnormality in these genes, then this regulator of apoptosis is lost and the cell grows unlimited. Next is the P53 on 17.4. These four regulator genes, or loss of it, causes cell proliferation. So all these leads to excessive growth of the cell, leading to the carcinomatous changes. So this is very much identifiable in 80% cases, that leads to adenoma carcinoma sequence. But there is another theory also, microsatellite instability mechanism, which is found in remaining 20% of carcinomatous change without polyps, without any adenomatous change. in there is an abrupt cancerous changes in the cells. That is the microsatellite instability mechanism. Normally in mitosis, when there is a replication of the DNA, then normal errors occur. But these errors are immediately guided and repaired by encoded enzymes from the normal genes. But whenever there is a germline mutation, that means when it becomes abnormal gene, then encoding of the enzymes is not there, so that these normal errors are not repaired, resulting into the replication of errors, and gradually it gets accumulated, and it is called a satellite, as a knob of chromosome connected by stalk to the short arm of the chromosome. This is in repeated sequence. This chromosome now becomes abnormal chromosome with mutant gene, also called colonic carcinogenic gene, and it is called hereditary non-polyposis colonic cancer. That means without any polyp formation, no adenoma, and there is a carcinomatous sequences develops. So this is all about the pathogenesis at the molecular level of the cancellar changes. So you have got a very beautiful diagram in your textbook, that is mucosa at risk, which becomes hyperplastic because of loss of mutation of APC locus on chromosome 5q, which leads to adenoma and dysplasia, which on progress leads to carcinoma in situ, and then there is a invasive carcinoma. So morphologically, this distribution of primary colonic carcinoma, that the cecum and ileocecal valve along with the is 10%, ascending colon and splenic and hepatic flexure is 5%, transverse colon is very uncommon sight, then there is a descending colon and sigmoid consumes about 25%, rectum is 60%. All colorectal carcinoma begins as in situ lesion or as button like areas of limited mass, but they evolve into different morphological patterns, mainly two types. Because of the nature passing food, nature of food which passes through it, right-sided growth, left-sided growth. Right-sided growth, they become polypoid, exophytic, fungating, large cauliflower-like growth that is soft, friable, which projects into the lumen, and there is no obstruction. Whereas in left-sided growth, in the distal colon, it becomes annular, encircling lesion, a so-called napkin ring constriction of bowel, of which margins are hipped, beaded, and very formed, and mid region is ulcerated. Both forms of neoplasma penetrates the bowel wall over the course of time and appears as subserosal and serosal white form mass. This causes puckering of the serosal surface. Microscopically, both sided colonic carcinoma have the same pattern, from tall columnar cells invading into the submucosa like adenomatous lesion to undifferentiated frank anaplastic cells. Invasive tumors inserts a strong desmoplastic stroma, which leads to form and hard consistency of most of the colonic carcinoma. As you know that desmoplasia is a characteristic of cancer cells, which liberates fibroblastic growth factor, leading to excessive fibrin formation. 95% of colorectal carcinoma presents with adenomatous of various glands of differentiation. So 5% of uncommon microscopic pattern, degree of differentiation from well differentiation to poorly differentiated cells. It can spread directly, circumferentially, or transverse into the depth of the bowel. Lymphatic spread to the regional lymph node. Hematogenous spread is very rare. Clinically, it represents very vague symptoms that the patient will complain of the altered bowel pattern. loss of appetite and occult blood. Complications are obstruction and hemorrhage, and diagnosis is very difficult. Estimation of the carcinoma embryonic antigen, that is 100% in metastatic lesions, 20-40% in early lesion, and the 60-70% in advanced primary lesion. This carcinoma embryonic antigen level is increased, but it has got also positive results in other type of carcinoma like lung, ovary and breast. Now the staging of this carcinoma colon has been done, so in order to know the prognosis, and it depends upon the extent of the bowel of the involvement, presence or absence of metastatic lesion, histological grading of the tumor and location of the tumor. So the staging shows the prognosis also by three ways: Duke's ABC staging, Hassler Kohler staging, which is widely used, and TNM staging. T stands for tumor, N for node, and M for metastasis. So stage A of Hassler Kohler staging 1, TNM classification is T1, N0, M0. Cancer is confined to the mucosa. In this case, if it is treated, then the 5-year survival will be more than 90%. When it passes into a stage B of ABC staging and Hassler Kohler staging 2, then the TNM classification becomes T2, N0, M0, and the cancer goes to submucosa, and the prognosis becomes 85% for 5-year survival. Then stage B2, the Hassler Kohler staging is still 2, and the TNM classification becomes T3, N0, M0. That means the tumor has spread to muscularized layer, but there is no nodal involvement, no metastasis, but the prognosis is 70-80%. Now the C1 staging of ABC and Hassler Kohler staging 3, then the tumor becomes TX, that means the muscular propria, and there is a regional lymph node involvement, so the prognosis becomes very less, 35-65% for 5 years. And then there is a C2 staging, the Hassler Kohler staging 3, TX N1 M0. Then the muscular propria, serous layer and regional lymph nodes are all involved, leading to prognosis to 20-30% for 5-year survival. And lastly, the D of ABC staging and Hassler Kohler staging, it is 4, and TNM classification is TX NX M1, and the survival rate for 5 years becomes only 5%, because the carcinoma has metastasized at the different places also. So this finishes the colorectal carcinoma, and just for the clinical point of view, I will tell you, if the patient comes with the bleeding from the mouth, then you will have to consider the causes in the upper GIT, which I have already told you. If the patient is coming with the bleeding through the anus, then it will be from the lower GIT, of which causes are, the first is the polyposis, which I have just told you, the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, Meckel's diverticulum interception, and the idiopathic inflammatory bowel disease, adenoma and adenocarcinoma. These are the causes of the bleeding from the lower GIT. And there is one more important cause of excessive bleeding, that is the hemorrhoids, that is the varicosities of the hemorrhoidal vein by any increase in venous pressure, portal hypertension, or even if by the constipation, there is a internal pile or external pile, the superior hemorrhoidal vein becomes engorged, tortuous and dilated, and inferior hemorrhoidal vein, when they also become tortuous, and when there is a pressure or even if constipation, then it starts bleeding. Besides that, anal fissure is an ulcer in the anal gland below the pectineal line that leads to bleeding through the anus. diverticulosis coli. These are the outpouching of the herniation of mucosa and some mucosa of the colon into the muscle wall. Low fiber diet is responsible for this muscular weakness, and the complication is perforation, hemorrhage and obstruction. So this finishes the GIT, lesions in the gastrointestinal tract. From next class I will teach you about the hepatobiliary system. Thank you.